Chapter 11, A Telegram. November came and the girls agreed it was the most disagreeable month in the year. Meg was at the kitchen table when Mrs. March came in and asked her usual question. Any letter from father, girls? Before Jo set off for the post office to see about the letter, there was a sharp ring at the door. Seconds later, Hannah came in with a telegram. Mrs. March snatched it, read it, and then dropped back into her chair. Jo took it from her and read aloud in a frightened voice. Mrs. March, your husband is very ill. Come at once to Washington. The room became incredibly still. I shall go immediately, Mrs. March said quietly. I hope it's not too late. At first, the only sound in the room was sobbing. But then everyone quickly set about to help Mrs. March get ready. Lori was to send a telegram and drop off a note at Aunt March's. The money for the sad journey would have to be borrowed. It was decided that Mr. Brooke would escort Mrs. March to Washington. By the time Lori returned, everything was arranged. Only Jo was nowhere to be found. Everyone began to worry. Then suddenly Jo burst in and laid a roll of bills before her mother. That's my contribution towards making father more comfortable and bringing him home. Mrs. March was stunned. My dear, where did you get $25? She asked. I hope you haven't done anything rash. No, it's mine, honestly, Jo replied. I didn't beg, borrow, or steal. I only sold what was my own. As she spoke, she removed her bonnet and everyone could see that her hair, the long hair she'd always been so proud of, had been cut off. An outcry rang out and Beth ran to tenderly hug her sister's cropped head. It was nothing really, Jo said, trying to sound casual. It feels so much lighter. But her family wasn't fooled. What made you do it? Asked Amy, who would just as soon cut off her head as her pretty long locks. I wanted to do something for father, Jo answered. As I was passing the barber shop, I noticed the hair pieces and asked if they bought hair. Without stopping to think, I asked him what he would give me for my hair. Mrs. March was overcome by her daughter's selflessness. No one wanted to go to bed, but by 10 o'clock, Mrs. March insisted. Beth played her father's favorite hymn on the piano before the girls went silently up to bed. Meg lay awake for a while after her sisters fell asleep, but suddenly she heard a stifled sob. She leaned over and touched her sister's cheek, only to find it was wet with tears. My hair, Jo sobbed into her pillow. I know it's vain and selfish of me, but I can't help it. Poor Jo, comforted Meg. The next morning they awoke before dawn and ate breakfast in silence. Mrs. March's trunk was packed and waiting in the hall by the door. When the carriage came, the sisters kissed and hugged their mother with all their might, then waved as she rode away. They watched as the carriage disappeared down the street. Jo hung her head and went into the kitchen. I feel as if there's been an earthquake, she said sadly. It's as if half the house is gone, Meg added. In the days following, news about their father comforted the girls. He was dangerously ill, but the presence of his wife had already done him some good. Mr. Brooks sent a message every day, and they became more and more cheerful as each week passed. Everyone was eager to write, and plump envelopes often jammed the March's postbox, waiting to be taken to Washington.